What if Germany won World War I? This is one of the most discussed alternate history scenarios, and I'd like to share my thoughts on it. I've done a lot of research about this topic and created my own scenario, which I will use as an example in this video. The video will be partitioned into three sections. First, the alternate course of the war. Second, the new order in Europe. And third, society and life in the German Empire. After the assassination on Franz Ferdinand by Gavrilo Princip, the war breaks out in accordance with our timeline on the 28th of July 1914, when the German Empire, Austria-Hungary, France, Russia, Montenegro and Serbia declare war on each other in the following days. But the German Empire is not undertaking the Schlieffen Plan through Belgium, which is the major difference in this timeline. Instead, a circa 250 km long line of defense is set up along the Alsace-Lorraine border in the west and is only defended with three armies. The French follow Plan 17, created by General Foch, and conquer Metz within the first few weeks while sieging Mühlhausen at the same time. Every time the French mount an assault, the German soldiers retreat behind the river front line and fortify their positions. This means that Belgium will stay untouched and Britain out of the war. More of the German armies fight rather in the east against the Russian Empire, which invades East Prussia and Galicia. Meanwhile, Bosnia is invaded by Serbia, but also here Austria-Hungary will stay more defensive. Led by Field Marshal Hindenburg and General Ludendorff, Germany would defeat Russian forces in East Prussia even quicker and could assist Austria in Galicia, all the while beginning to conquer the Russian province of Poland. Germany would still send Lenin back to Russia, either in 1916 or 1917, where he contributes to the outbreak of the Civil War. Germany's front into Russia would then be open, and they could conquer large areas of land up to Kiev and also all the way through the Baltic states up to Finland. Meanwhile, French forces failed to break through the German lines with their Plan 17, and they are stuck at the Moselle and Rhine rivers. Germany can keep them on spot using trench warfare and tactical retreats. However, Britain wouldn't allow it that Germany conquers most of Eastern Europe, as according to them it would destroy a balance of powers. They'd find a reason for declaration of war, for example a maritime incident, or a conflict that happened in the colonies as a result of tension. Britain would however need some time for mobilization and to ship their troops over to France where they land on the Channel coast. Now Italy would leave the so-called Dreibund with Germany and Austria-Hungary and open up a new front from the south in order to conquer claimed Austrian territories. Romania, Greece, Portugal and other additional states would also enter or be pushed to enter on the Entente side, influenced by the British decision to join. Besides the attack on Germany, Britain will also fight against the Ottoman Empire in Mesopotamia and Gallipoli. Germany has to react fast and bring in fresh experienced troops from the Eastern Front to the Western and Southern one. Now that Britain is in the war, Germany will march through Belgium. But even now they don't perform the Schlieffen Plan, but a more risky maneuver. A single cut through the Ardennes forest to separate the landing British troops and to encircle the French in the south is performed. As soon as the French retreat in panic, the German armies at the Rhine can push them out of Alsace again. Even Austria would be able to send troops for aid, while the revolutionary Russia is already talking about peace negotiations. Britain would easily overrun the German colonies, of course. Only General Paul von Lettow-Vorbeck could resist with a long guerrilla war in East Africa. Japan, which had already conquered Tsingtao in the first few weeks, would also try the same with the other German Pacific colonies, together with Australia and New Zealand. The Ottoman Empire would fight the Russians in the Caucasus Mountains, with varying degrees of success for both sides. And they will try to stop the British forces in Kut in Mesopotamia. There will also never be a Zimmermann telegraph, and Germany is careful to not pull the USA into the war. food and supplies from Ukraine and other occupied states, ensure that there are new reserves for Germany, and the population isn't under the threat of starvation anymore. After Germany's sieges and conquered Paris, the British army could be pushed back to the Channel, while losses on French side caused uprisings within their forces. Both France and Britain agreed to peace negotiations, and 1 year after Britain settles for a white peace, and with no one seeing a way to defeat the opposing side, the war would be effectively over. Let's see how the victorious Central Powers would order Europe after the war. There would be similar treaties to the ones of Brest-Litovsk and Versailles. Let's call the treaty with Russia the Treaty of Lemberg, and the one with France the Treaty of Charlottenburg. Alongside, there would be treaties with the other defeated nations as well, such as Italy, Romania and Portugal. The German leadership had many plans for new borders in the West, with the more radical ones being the demand of the Pan-German League, also called Alldeutscher Verband, who wanted to annex all of northeastern France and even Belgium. But Germany would most likely take only smaller chunks to appease Britain, which with a German annexation of Belgium that could threaten British coasts. Of course, Germany would still try to gain as much influence as possible in Belgium, but they wouldn't try to replace King Albert I with a German one. In my scenario, Germany annexes the western foothills of the Vosges Mountains, the coal mining area of Longwy-Brie, Luxembourg and the land surrounding Alor. France would also probably have to pay a large sum of reparations, lose some of its colonial territory, be restricted from operating any forts between the German border and Paris, and have its army reduced to 50,000 men. A demilitarized zone along the border, like what happened to Germany in the Treaty of Versailles, would also be enforced. Belgium would lose the colony of Congo to Germany and become a puppet or at least a heavily influenced state. But Britain wouldn't lose anything. It is more likely that they would come to share some of the colonies with Germany in a joint administration, but we will come back to colonies a bit later. There's really no way Germany could demand anything from Britain. Their navy is too strong and their geographical isolation makes them difficult to invade. Now let's head to the east, where the biggest changes would happen. Here, Germany never actually planned to directly annex a lot. Only a proposal for the annexation of a strip of Polish land adjacent to the border appeared most often in plans. But Russia would be forced to release several newly created states that would then come under German control. These states would be Poland, Lithuania, either several Baltic states or a united Baltic duchy as it did on this map, Finland, Belarus and Ukraine. Additionally, there would be new states east of Ukraine and in the Caucasus. These being Donland, Kuban and the mountainous Republic of Northern Caucasus that would also come under German rule but would be very unstable. It should be noted that Finland wouldn't get the Arctic Sea Access Corridor at Petsamo. That was a 1920s deal with a different Finnish government. All of these states would get pro-German leaders like Pavlo Skoropetsky, or even a German king like Archduke Wilhelm of Austria. Poland was to have Archduke Karl Albrecht of Austria as king, Finland Prince Frederick Charles of Hesse as king, Albania Wilhelm of Wied as prince, but in Romania, King Ferdinand I, who fought against the Central Powers despite being from the House of Hohenzollern, would be replaced with his son Karl II. The other states would also get Hohenzollern or Habsburg princes as their new monarchs. The Austro-Hungarian Empire would annex several Carpathian valleys from Romania, as well as Venetia and Lombardy from Italy, two regions they have already owned back in the 19th century. Bulgaria, being on the victorious side, would become very huge, annexing Dobruja from Romania, large parts of Serbia, all of Macedonia and a small part of Greece. Serbia, now an Austrian puppet, would be allowed to unite with Montenegro and Romania with Moldova. After all, the Central Powers wouldn't want these states as eternal enemies. The Ottoman Empire would annex Russian regions in the Southern Caucasus and create puppets such as a small Armenia, Georgia and Azerbaijan. Of course, they would also annex Greek islands adjacent to its western coast. Cyprus would remain British for now. All of these new states would be in a German and Austrian-dominated confederation, which I called the Deutscher Bund, the German Confederation, as most of the monarchs would be German. Germany, together with Austria, would be the de facto dominating force within it. But Austria itself would still have to reform and solve its ethnical tension problems, probably by creating a new Slavic state of Croatia by the Adriatic Sea, all under the rule of the new Greater Austria. New flags, symbols and an anthem would be created for this federation of monarchies. Germany would carry out its plans for Africa and take French, Belgian and probably Portuguese colonies to form Mittelafrika. Additionally, they'd get German West Africa, German Eritrea and the German Protectorate of Morocco. Italy, having settled with an early agreement before the end of the war itself, would have lost all of its colonies. Some of its colonies are even snatched by Britain, out of spite that they abandoned the war effort earlier, but also so that not all of the colonies are open to the Central Powers for taking. Taking Portuguese colonies as well, Britain attempts to cover up their large loss of lives throughout the war, distracting the public from the idea of a defeat. Austria could get Libya and Tunisia from Italy and France respectively, because the short sail across the Mediterranean would allow Austria to maintain them with ease. I doubt more colonies would be taken in Asia and Japan wouldn't be able to take Germany's Pacific colonies. However, I can see Germany agreeing to sell Tsingtao to Japan, so that they wouldn't have to deal with a potential future conflict in which a distance puts them at a disadvantage. As in our timeline, Russia could have a comeback in the early 20s after the Civil War has ended and would threaten the eastern borders of the young German Confederation. Also, new conflicts could arise from internal problems, especially in the multi-ethnic states of Greater Austria and Bulgaria. This includes the Polish-inhabited areas of eastern Germany, with the newly annexed border strip where Germanization attempts are being resisted. Also, communist movements in Germany would gain momentum. The unstable states such as Donland, Kuban and the mountainous Republic of Northern Caucasus would probably fall back to Russia, with both sides having to agree to a new treaty and borders. Even though Greater Austria was on the victorious side, the ethnic tensions of the time wouldn't cease. The Great State would probably dissolve, but in this timeline without foreign powers dictating the new borders, rather together all the peoples of the state, with Germany acting as mediator. Austria would probably demand the German-speaking areas along the other side of the border with Hungary, the Burgenland, split Galicia between Poland and Ukraine, and for a small amount of money give Venetia and Lombardy back to Italy. I don't think they'd give away any part of Old Tyrol, not even the Italian one. Neither would they give away Bohemia out of geostrategical reasons, or their only sea access in Istria on the Mediterranean Sea. These regions would probably get some level of autonomy, but remain in the new kingdom of Austria. It's very likely that Austria would not join the German Empire, because they, unlike today, identified closer as Germans and would now see the opportunity to unite themselves into one all-encompassing German state. This new state would be still called the German Empire, but also Greater Germany by the people inspired by the Pan-Germanic idea of 1848. In my timeline, I decided that Germany, in order to lower tensions with France and Poland, gives back the respectively annexed border strips after new Kaiser is coronated in the mid-1920s. However, we can't know, it is also possible that they would simply be kept. I returned them in my timeline as I believe Germany would probably want to convince France to join the Confederation and to neutralize the threat in the West. The return of largely Polish-inhabited areas, namely Western Galicia, from the dissolved Greater Austria, and later the annexed border strip could quell tension in the east too. It is possible that Lithuania has a dispute about its Polish-inhabited southern regions, but in the timeline it dissolved with an autonomous area, to which Poland agrees in the spirit of the old friendship and union with Lithuania. More states would join the now so-called Reichsbund, the Imperial Confederation, such as Belgium, the Netherlands, some of the Scandinavian states and Greece. I doubt in particular Norway would, because it has just gotten its independence from Sweden in 1905, and even today in our timeline it hasn't joined the European Union. It would probably agree to some free trading treaties though. The Ottoman Empire would also undoubtedly fall apart due to rising Arabic nationalism, but could get away with keeping more regions in the southeast. When Austria joins the German Empire, we'd probably see huge reforms and political conferences taking several years to create a new political structure. Accordingly, I reformed the Inner Reichsländer, the imperial states, as you can see. While Berlin is the capital of the empire, Vienna would be the capital of the Imperial Confederation, like how Brussels is the capital of our EU. If we see a second Great War in the 1940s, it would probably involve the members of the Confederation against the Soviet Union, that is also led by Joseph Stalin, a Britain that never accepted German domination in mainland Europe, the possibly fascist states of Spain and Italy, possibly a USA that decides to assist their British allies, and finally a 50-50 chance of a France. The French administration, however, could choose to help Germany fight down the Soviets or simply remain neutral. I imagine that one reason for another war could be the development of nuclear weapons in Germany. Without the Nazis taking control of the country, many of the brilliant scientists who fled the emerging regime would instead stay and help give the Federation defense against Soviet and other threats from outside. The enemies of the Confederation would probably see their time is running out and would initiate a war in order to hold a possible irreversible German domination in Europe. We will probably see communist movements throughout the Confederation trying to separate states away from the community or weaken them from within. Spies would try to spread pro-Soviet ideas and build networks for the purpose of sabotage. If the Imperial Confederation wins this war as well, it would mean the end of the Soviet Union in the 1940s. More states would end up joining the Confederation, turning it into a real European Union-like community, in which the most developed states would culturally and technologically bloom in the coming decades. Next, we want to have a little look at the society, technology, and future of this Germany after World War I. In this scenario, the whole political system of Europe would be different to ours. The First World War was also a war of ideologies, and the outcome of our timeline spelled an end to monarchical Europe. In this alternate timeline, however, we would see a Europe where monarchy dominates and everything would revolve around the Kaiser and his significance. It doesn't mean that there wouldn't be any liberal reforms though. Social Democrats would still have influence and would slowly make society more liberal and better for the working class. But it would be a much softer change. Communism would still have supporters and the Soviet Union would try to spread its ideology all over Europe. It's also uncertain what would happen to China and Japan and whom of the two Germany and the Imperial Confederation would support. But the greatest change of all would be no Nazis. It is very unlikely that a similar national socialistic and racist movement could gain as much power as the NSDAP of Adolf Hitler did in our timeline. The Holocaust would never happen and the monarchy would keep society stable, keeping radical movements under control. Hitler would stay in the German army for a few more years, but never become bitter and go into politics. He would probably try to live being an artist again. He could maybe become a normal family father you could have a cup of tea with. While the Imperial Confederation would be a kind of monarchist EU, the USA would stay more isolationist but also rise to being an economic superpower, having its cultural and economic impact on the world. Its influence would not exceed the power of the Confederation foe. It's also very likely that fascism would still rise in Italy and Spain. Now let's have a look at the culture and society in this greater Germany. As well as politically, Germany would also dominate culturally. German would be the first foreign language in most of the European countries and would stay the international language of signs. A new German language academy might provide new words for trends and inventions, such as Weltnetz for internet or Handphone for mobile phone. The trend to name children names of Germanic heritage would continue, and interest for Germanic ancestors and religion might experience a revivalist movement, like how neo-pagan groups in our timeline have appeared. Modern culture as we know it would still come up with people like actress Marlene Dietrich or painter Emil Nolde. Also before 1914 in the Kaiserreich, artists like Franz Marc, known for Der Blaue Reiter, were tolerated by the Kaiser, so we'd never see a censorship that we saw under the Nazis in our timeline. Later on, we might even see pop and rock music genres imported from the US, with new German bands composing their own native rock music. The concept of skyscrapers imported from US cities like Chicago, New York, might find popularity too. It's very possible that a building boom begins, especially in Berlin and other big cities that attract many Eastern European immigrants. And discipline and obedient behavior would be seen as very important, similar to society in today's Japan. Technologically, Germany was on top back then at the beginning of the 20th century, and many Nobel Prize winners and world-famous scientists came from there. Since we never have the Nazis, great men like Einstein, Wernher von Braun, Otto Hahn and Konrad Zuse stay and will probably pursue the same careers. And obviously, the Germans would still create their Autobahnen. The threat of the Soviet Union, of Britain and of fascist and internal enemies will cause pressure, and the government will continue to invest in new military technologies. For example, Junkers would develop excellent aircraft and rocket technology in the 30s and 40s. And of course, the help of scientists like Otto Hahn and Werner Heisenberg would create the nuclear mega-weapon. After the Second World War, there might be a hype for space, where the German Space Association could set the first man on the moon by the 50s, and there might be investment in Zuse's work on early computers. This would also lead to an earlier creation of the internet invented in Germany, known as the Weltnetz or WorldNet. And German corporations could spread all over the world once economic globalization begins. In conclusion, all of this is very speculative, and a million things that could alter the course of history could be considered. However, I tried to make a scenario as realistic as possible, and I hope you enjoyed it. I thank everyone who helped me with the informations and graphics for this video, I will link them in the description. And now, let me know in the comments what you think, share and upvote the video if you liked it, and have a nice day!